A lot of things happening over in the last 48 hours here in the Capitol, with cutoff in both chambers yesterday at 5 o'clock and a number of big bills that have moved out. But I think the big news of the, at least locally here this morning, is the revenue forecast showing that between what we expect to see in lower spending needs at the caseload forecast later in the week and what we've seen with increased revenues at both this and the previous revenue forecast, close to $2.5 billion in additional resources coming into state government this year. Last night, expecting those great resources to be coming in, Senate Republicans pushed for substantial property tax reductions in our McCleary bill that we debated last night on the floor of the Senate. We were disappointed that Democrats were unwilling to consider those at that time. Though I will say that we will have some renewed optimism with some of the comments this morning, that there actually may be some desire from some Democrats to explore property tax relief for those communities that are experiencing higher rates this year. That's important. We recognize that we did a hard thing last year in passing the McCleary bill. It was a bipartisan piece of legislation that passed with over 70% of the legislature, and it was passed with an expectation that we needed those resources to be able to solve our K-12 problems. Fortunately, when more resources show up, we're then faced with a choice. Do we spend that on bigger government and more spending in other areas, or do we prioritize it for those things that we need to do, like transportation and special education and property tax reliefs? That's where I think Republicans have fairly much united behind, and those are the types of things that we'll be pursuing as we work with the Democrats towards the close of session. I know there are a number of other issues that came up in the last 24 hours as we approach cutoff, and so I want to keep my introductory remarks short, but I look forward to your questions.
Well, thank you for being here. I'm Dan Christensen, the House Minority Leader. We did finish cutoff, of course, last evening, and so now we go into the real sprint. It was a plus for all of us, I think, that we saw more revenue come in here than it was expected. That's on the plus side. I do want to, however, make sure that we're cautious in how we jump forward in spending any of that new revenue, whether it be one-time spending or whether it be spending that we're going to have to depend on over the years to come, is always a challenge. It wasn't all that long ago, back in 2007, we were faced with the state's largest surplus of $2 billion back then, only to be followed with an $11 billion sway to a $9 billion deficit 2 years later because of the recession that smacked us. And so I want to make sure that the decisions that we're making are sustainable, that they are decisions that are not going to put us in a deep hole, that we're respectful to the taxpayers with, you know, when it comes to, you know, how well the economy is right now. The whole point of having these extra accounts, surplus accounts and whatnot for us, is to be able to, when times turn around and we've got some emergencies or bad times, that we're able to fill that gap as well. With me, I've got to my left Representative Drew Stokesbury, and we're looking forward to your questions.
The property tax issue, it sounds like there's bills that are going to be introduced in both the House and the Senate. I think the House later today will get details, and the Senate will be next week. Have there been any discussions between the chambers on what those measures might look like and whether it's something that you all would be on board with, and how they differ from the Republican proposals?
I'm not aware of how the Democrats plan on constructing their proposed property tax plan. We know that what we proposed last night on the Senate floor was rejected, and that's probably one of the easiest ways to accomplish the goal of adjusting for that 2018 spike in property taxes. So my concern is that their plan may not go far enough in providing the kind of relief that we can afford to provide. But I would like to echo the Minority Leader's comment, which we are prone to swings. We don't want to dramatically increase spending in other areas with ongoing expenses because we are experiencing a one-time bump in revenue. And so that's what we're going to keep a careful look for.
The other thing, too, that we want to be careful of is that, you know, when we start looking at property taxes and the cuts, is there an offset somewhere else? In other words, are we going to cut taxes in one place so that you can say that you cut taxes only to then overshadow it by a tax increase somewhere else? The Democrats are in control of both budgets in the House and in the Senate. My understanding is that the Senate Democrats are supposed to be rolling their budget out on Monday and how they plan on funding it, and the House Democrats are supposed to be running their budget out on Tuesday and how they plan on funding that. With respect to the new revenue forecast coming up as high as it did, it'll be interesting to see if they make any adjustments to it and how they deal with that next week.
through. My expectation would be that the Democrats' plan includes essentially another tax swap, this time reducing state property tax while raising other taxes, like Dan alluded to, perhaps the capital gains tax or maybe a carbon tax. And the fact of the matter is that it's simply not necessary after today's good news. We got $1.2 billion of new money over the four-year outlook that we didn't realize we were going to have when we went to bed last night. And there simply is no need to argue over one group of taxpayers versus another in terms of who should pay. Nobody needs to pay. In fact, we can reduce taxes without needing to raise them elsewhere. We've got the capacity to do it. And spending all the money, like Dan said, is going to create this enormous bow wave. And at some point, the market won't continually increase at 12-15% a year.
What leads you to say that you think the carbon tax or capital gains tax will be in the Democratic budget?
Well, for one, the House Finance Committee is hearing the bill that's sponsored by the House Finance Committee chair on Friday regarding the capital gains tax. And it's scheduled for executive session on Monday. Mm-hmm. That typically doesn't happen. If you're the chair of a committee, you don't schedule a hearing and an executive session for your bill if you don't plan to pass it. And you also, when you're the top finance person, you don't really go out and do things on your own without coordinating with the rest of your leadership team and the rest of your budget writers. So I don't know anything for sure. I just would be surprised, because it would be very unusual in this place for a finance committee chair to do her own thing, not in coordination with the rest of the caucus and her leadership team.
And I can't speak for what's going to go on in the House. I actually don't expect that those revenue sources will be booked in the Democrats' budget that will be released next week. And I think there could be differences between the House and the Senate Democratic budgets on that regard, but I don't have any additional information on that.
You mentioned earlier, what amount of property tax relief would you like to see?
I think that there. So I think what we offered on the Senate floor yesterday, which was pretty much a complete elimination of the 2018 property tax spike that we all recognized was necessary in order to meet our McCleary obligations when we didn't have the type of revenue that we're now seeing coming to the state. And so I think it is both affordable as well as quite reasonable to do that. One of the frustrations I had during the floor debate yesterday is, there's such a desire on the other side of the aisle to paint this in partisan terms. But for those individuals that didn't support the property tax increase last year that were arguing against doing that, and there were a few of them who were arguing against doing that, for them to turn around and then vote no on an amendment that would eliminate the property tax increase is really the height of hypocrisy. And so I'm trying to figure out just where they're actually coming from, because we can't seem to make them happy.
Senator, thank you. You're just looking at a one-year deferral that 81 cents would come back. It will arrive again. They just will get
They're offset.
2019, they'll get that break, and they'll be back in 2020. So this year they pay, next year they don't.
So there are two issues that are really important. One is, are we providing the proper rate of property tax relief for our communities? And so by eliminating that 2018 spike, which we all recognize is a difficult issue for families all across the state, but 80% of taxpayers get a tax cut next year when local levies come down. And one of the interesting things that I was hearing last night is there was some big difference between state and local levies. At the end of the day, it's all what's coming out. It's all the money that's coming out of somebody's pocketbook, and they don't care whether they're paying it to the county or to the state or the school district. And so we need to make sure that we're providing that property tax relief that we can afford to now with one-time good news and a one-time spending decision.
The mechanism for doing that, though, because it is unconstitutional to offer a refund, we've been told earlier today. So, and some people have already paid their property tax. Some people have paid all of their property tax for the year. So how do you make sure that's fair for everybody and everybody gets back what you're reaping?
So the deferral, that's what the deferral does. So if you've already paid your property taxes this year, the April 30th, then you're going to owe more in October. So you're going to get the deferral in October. If you paid your full year's property tax, then you're going to get the credit in the following year of the taxes that you've already paid.
Is that a concept that Republicans support, using the deferral mechanism?
There are a number of different ways to accomplish this. Some of them, if you're talking about state property taxes and you're addressing that issue, then the deferral is one way to accomplish that. When we're talking about local levies, it's about bringing down those local levy amounts. at the local school district. It really depends on what the end of the day solution is on compensation for teachers in light of the Supreme Court's most recent order. So there are a number of different things that are moving around here, and no matter what the end decision is, there is a solution to accommodate property tax relief, and I think that's the important message taking home.
Can you get property tax relief and meet the Supreme Court's ruling that you have to move up the salaries for teachers?
While I've always been resistant on moving up the salaries for teachers because I think it's a lot of administrative headache for real no benefit for kids, and I would rather us put our energies towards increasing the amount of money that goes into transportation, increasing the amount of money that goes into special education, and so that's been something that I think may not be worth the effort. If that's something we end up doing at the end of the day, the most important thing that we need to look out for is not creating a new cliff for school districts. If we upfront that money, and then don't lower local levies in concert, we will actually see some school districts get an extraordinary amount of money this year and then see a cut next year. And as we already know, school districts have been asking constantly for additional help in bargaining with their representative unions, because whenever there's money left on the table, when bargaining is commences, it usually gets bargained away. And we don't want to create another McCleary crisis 10 years down the road, and we certainly don't want to create a McCleary crisis 1 year down the road.
Different topic, and I ask you about the situation that happened in Florida yesterday. And is there a concern on your part that there's going to be an overreaction and push for more gun control? And I know you've been talking about mental health as the solution versus more gun control. Are you concerned that there's going to be an overreaction?
I believe there's probably going to be a reaction. There always is something. They always come back and say, we need to do something. Well, we can have this gun debate, but that's not the issue here. The issue is the mental health problems. Why? After everything that we knew about this troubled teenager, I guess he's teenager still, why were they so fearful of coming forward and telling people that? I mean, we had teachers, we had neighbors, and the guy was involved in, he bragged about how he liked to kill small animals and how he liked to, he bragged about everything, his gun issues and all that. And with all that out there, why in the world was someone not let know that he had such a trouble? That's the issue here, is that we have mental health problems in this country, and we really need to deal with that. This is not a gun issue, because he could have chosen anything to do what he did, but he didn't. He chose that. But if there's evil in their heart, that is what they're going to do. So, you know, I really think that there may be something going forward. I mean, there was a whole lot of gun bills this year, but that's not addressing the problem.
You mentioned that in Florida that it was a teenager who bought an AR-15 legally and committed this massacre. Teenagers in our state can also buy AR-15s legally. Mm-hmm. Should that be changed?
I don't know that that's going to solve our problems. The thing is, we're talking about a particular gun. The same thing could be accomplished with any other gun that's out there. They act the same way. You pull the trigger once, and it's the cartridge is released.
But the legislation that was proposed here would have covered all rifles.
That's true, but if it's
to 21,
so if you
why not do that?
If you limit the gun, you limit the rifle, you're still going to have the other guns out there, right? So you can't limit this. This is not a gun issue. This is a mental health issue. This person was very troubled. He needed to have help.
What specifically would Republicans like to do to support mental health intervention for teenagers?
Well, I have actually gone out. I'm interested in that as well, and I just passed a bill that is called Mental Health for Heroes. It's about dealing with the issues like veterans have in higher education, so in four-year colleges, so that they will have a mental health counselor that will be there specifically for their unique needs.
What about high schoolers?
Well, that's exactly, we need to be looking at all of this. I think that some of the money that we're putting toward and energy we're putting toward this, we need to be putting toward mental health.
Property tax relief for mental health, which one's more of a priority this session?
We're in a great situation where we actually don't need to choose between the two. We've got absolute plenty of resources to be able to accomplish both. You know, on the mental health front, we've made a 68% increase in funding for Western State Hospital in the last couple of years. And we still have a lot of problems there. And I think our concern is that those problems really fall squarely on the administration. They are management problems, not as much funding problems when it comes to Western State. But when we look out into our communities, we have to decide what kind of a mental health framework we want for the future. Senator Braun has put forward an incredibly good proposal that will actually start looking more like our DD system, where we have actually put these mental health facilities out into the community. He's sponsored legislation that would have about $500 million in bonding to help build capital facilities for mental health purposes. And this is important because it not only takes the pressure off of Western State Hospital, where we know there are managerial problems, but it also, very importantly, takes some of the pressure off of the local hospitals, where we have seen a lot of these folks just boarded in the hallways, waiting on their 72-hour hold, and not getting the treatment that they need. That's the kind of solution that that we've put forward, and that we really hope will get a fair shake towards the end of session, because it'll make a real difference for all these problems.
Something else related to the gun issue I'd like to bring up that I don't know that it's even been talked about, and that is that, you know, we provide protection, arm protection at our banks, our armored vehicles that are going around picking up cash, even the governor's office. There's even security staff and state patrol here that are armed to protect even us as legislators, and you all, by the way, who are here on the campus. But yet the most precious among us, our kids, we don't allow it there. Mm-hmm. We're not allowing to protect our own kids in the same way we're protecting the adults, the same way we're protecting our money. At what point do we, you know, we can talk about eliminating guns and all this and that. While we're solving those problems, why are we not talking about the lack of protection that we're not providing protection for our own kids? Yes, we all acknowledge there's a mental illness problem. We acknowledge that there's people that may have improper access to weapons. You know, and I don't know if you know this, hopefully some of you do, there's over 22,000 laws on the books nationwide restricting guns. None of those saved the kids in this horrific action that took place. This young man broke numerous laws before he ever pulled the trigger, not unlike all the other shootings that we hear about. Not unlike the person who killed my family member, who broke several laws before they ever pulled the trigger and killed my family member. Why are we not willing to talk about, as we're trying to solve those problems, protecting, because we have the ability to do it, protecting the most precious among us, being our kids? And that's a challenge. And listen to me, please. We have resources to be able to do this. We have training that's available. We have numerous people that are already on our schools that are already, we've got military veterans there that are school teachers. We've got people that are trained. We can offer training to these people to get people, you know, to protect the most vulnerable among us. And yet it gets politicized. I'm like, what's wrong with protecting our kids? That's my question. Why has that not been the priority? We seem to think that eliminating guns is a priority. That's not gonna, the bad people with evil intent are still going to get their guns, and they're still going to go out there because, as was mentioned earlier, they've got evil in them. And until you get somebody who has got that equalizer to be able to stop them or at least slow them down, why are we not focusing in on that? And what's the taboo about protecting our kids with somebody who's on site there to do so? Whether it be a police officer or somebody else who's staff who's trained.
Would you pinpoint the laws that you're talking about? Certainly police officers can carry their weapons on campus, and there are police officers on many campuses.
Well, then why do we not have more police officers on our campuses? And why are we not looking at maybe providing more revenue to do that? Why are we not allowing for training of citizens out there who can be certified to go out there and carry and protect these kids among us? Because that is something that if we're not good, I mean, we're gonna continue to have, you know, everybody likes to call it the safe zone. It's the most unsafe place as a victim to be, because the only people that are there with a gun are the perpetrators set on evil intent. And we have options among us in this legislature and within our school boards. I'm not saying that every district, every school should have a police officer there. I'm saying we empower our local school boards, we give them some options to provide for security out there, be it through the locals, be it through training of staff, be it through, maybe they've got within their budgets to have police officers out on the campuses. But I just believe that while we're wrestling and grappling with this bigger issue nationwide, why are we not focusing on what can we do now within our existing resources to help protect our kids? Go ahead. I can't hear all of you talking at the same time.
One or two people coming with AR-15s, are you talking about heavily armed guards or long guns and body armor in schools? Because like one person with a handgun somewhere in the school might not be able to respond.
That's better than nobody.
Okay. There's one more thing that we need to be talking about as well, active shooter training, the drills themselves. Because I've had my schools come to me and say, we need to have, we do it for earthquake drills and we do it for fire drills. But they're not doing active shooter training, and this seems to be the more issue here these days. Besides the fact that they're going to feel more in control. If you go through this process, you're going to know what to do instead of just mayhem inside the school. You saw, this guy planned this ahead of time. He pulled the fire drill so that everyone came out of their rooms. Now that's
and there was a guard at that school though, and he just happened to not encounter him. Right. So getting back to Joe's question, unless you have like a force on a school, a lot of these schools, especially in Florida, they're sprawling, they're in suburban areas, they're separate buildings. This building that was attacked was not attached, it's not like one main school. So unless you have multiple guards and armed guards in each school, which I imagine could lead to a potential unfunded mandate on some of these districts. How do you address that?
Well, maybe we should fund it.
Maybe we should fund it. You know, what's our priority here?
Right.
You know, let's take a look at some of the other programs and the areas that we're spending money down here. You know, I don't know about you, but, you know, I had to swear my right hand to uphold the Constitution of this state and the United States of America. And there are things within there that talk about protecting of our citizens. There's a lot of other things we spend money on down here that have nothing to do with anything that's even, frankly, within the Constitution. But as we're grappling with this thing about let's take on guns, let's take on mental illness, those are big issues, and we're going to continue working them. What I'm saying is, if we need to put resources toward it or change policies to allow our local school boards to protect the most vulnerable that we have, our kids, why are we not doing that? What's the stonewall in not allowing for that to take place? Because that's what I've seen more of. I've seen that we are not allowing for our own citizens to protect the most vulnerable among us, while at the same time, we have prioritized that money must be more valuable than kids. The governor, us as the legislature, we must be more valuable than the kids, because we allow for armed guards. For Pete's sake, even the Hollywood actors who are against guns have armed guards protecting many of them. But we're fighting not allowing for us to protect our own kids. Makes no sense to me. Go ahead.
I understand that, but and you've got $1.5 billion now. So are we going to see a proposal from either Republican caucus to either provide money for armed security for police or provide the money for active shooter drills? Because you tell the schools that they need to have active shooter drills, they're going to say, well, you already require us to do all these other things. We don't have the time in the day in the school year, so.
I think that it's time to have the conversation. I think that it's time to have the conversation because it's something that, look, my kids are precious. Hopefully someday I'm going to have grandkids. They're going to be precious. And all of you, the kids among us are our best asset that we have. We spend more money in government on education on our kids than anything else, whether it be their education or their health care. Why are we not providing for their well-being as far as their security, not just at the in their education, not just in their healthcare, but if they're in a situation that could take their lives, for Pete's sake, why are we not helping that out, or at least through policy and money, putting our money and our policy where our mouth is at? Well, I got to tell you, it's been a discussion amongst us just here, especially I think it's been prompted not only with what happened yesterday, which was horrific, but it has been something that we've been talking about quite a bit over the last several months. Yes.
It's pretty late in the session, but are the Republicans going to introduce a specific bill, say next session, saying we're going to allocate X amount of dollars for armed guards?
We have had bills in the past that were trying to allow for the training and the ability to put security on schools that we haven't even been able to get hearings on. That's why I'm saying, why are we not talking about that? Why are we not pushing our chairs to even allow for hearings on these bills?
You got to introduce the bill to...
Well, it doesn't have to do with armed security guards, but there's already a bill out there. For the last 4 years I've been here, Republicans have introduced a bill that would create an anonymous system for students to text in situations that they're aware of and that cause them to be afraid of. everything we've heard out of Florida says there are kids that have this suspicion. It's Bill 2442 this session. It's a Manuelin bill. It was a Parker bill before he left. That has never come to the floor of the House. It would cost virtually nothing. It would have almost certainly made an effect when in this Florida example. Mm-hmm. And we can't even get those nearly free solutions to get hearings.
And by the way, the original prime sponsor of the bill, Kevin Parker, was a counselor at Columbine during the shooting. He was there, and he was a state legislator here. He tried to get the bill through, couldn't get a hearing on it. There's just, with the technology we have, why are we so scared about protecting our kids, for Pete's sakes?
What I'm trying to get at is, next session, are you going to, is your side going to introduce a specific bill saying we want at least two armed guards at each, and I'll make up the numbers as I go, but requires a minimum number of armed guards at schools with this amount of money that we want to allocate for it?
You can try and pin me down on whatever you want. I'm one of 147 legislators. I wouldn't be surprised if a bill like that or several others similar, or whether it comes to allowing for the training of and utilizing existing staff that we have in some cases that we already have on our school grounds,
so
whether it be a teacher.
About teachers and other security staff, training them to use weapons if they want to be trained and making that legal. Is it illegal for a teacher to have a weapon if they're trained? Is it illegal to train other civilian staff or parents or PTSA?
It's not illegal, but right now you're not allowing for the school to have even people with a gun on the campus. And so unless it's a police officer currently, you know, we're going to have to make some policy changes, because in some cases, look, I mean, if we're going to try and put an armed guard in every school campus, or two or three, depending on the size, you're talking about hundreds of millions of dollars to do something like that when we already have a lot of people that are trained. The question is, can we, through our policy, allow for a certain type of certification and training to allow those people who have passed those background tests, that have passed the certification tests, that are, you know, which I would call, they've got virtually the same kind of training as somebody who's a police officer, you know, at least with that, with respect to the security detail, to be able to be on campus. We're not allowing for bills like that to even be heard, let alone this bill here, 2442, which has been on the books here for years. Hopefully, we're going to see the chair of the House Education Committee willing to even hear this bill and pass it out, because this is just a mobile app. You know, all of our kids today have got mobile phones today, virtually all of them do. Why not for allowing for these apps to be on these phones, so these kids, if they're seeing a situation like what happened, you know, down in Florida, where kids saw what was going on, weren't able to communicate. We've got the technology today. Let's focus in on some of the things we know we can do easily that are the most cost effective right now. And so we'll continue working on these other issues.
Last question. Well, yeah. I should say, Joel, I mean, you have professional security here on the Capitol campus. Mm-hmm. That's still a very different thing than getting a few teachers certified.
We also have, you know, our security staff, and many of them are retired police officers or military.
Yeah. All right, thank you, everyone.
Thank you.